This video is brought to you by MyWayTeaching.com.
So in this particular part, let us study Newton's third law of motion. The second law relates the external force on a body to its acceleration. What is the origin of the external force on the body? What agency provides the external force? And the simplest answer in Newton mechanics is that the external force on a body always arises due to some other body. Consider a pair of bodies A and B. Okay, you just consider a pair of bodies, that is A and B, and this B exerts external force on A. Okay. A natural question is, does A in return exerts force on B? In some examples, the answer seems clear. For example, if you press a spring, right, it will compress, isn't it? Whenever you press a spring with more force, it will compress. At that time, you can express, you can feel the force which is exerted by this string on your hand. So at that time, both the bodies are exerting force on each other. And in some other cases, here both the bodies are in contact. The compressed spring in turn exerts a force on your hand and you can feel that. But what if the bodies are not in contact? Yes, the earth pulls a stone downwards due to gravity. Does the stone exert a force on the earth in turn? The answer is not so obvious here, but according to Newton, it's yes. The stone does exert an equal and opposite force on the earth. We do not notice it since the earth is very massive and the effect of a small force on its motion is negligible. Thus, according to Newton mechanics, force never occurs singly in nature. Force is the mutual interaction between two bodies. According to Newton, force is the mutual interaction between two bodies. Mutual interaction between two bodies. So forces always occur in pairs. Further, the mutual forces between two bodies are always equal and opposite. So the idea was expressed by Newton in the form of the third law of motion. So the Newton's third law says that to every action, there is always an equal and opposite reaction. Okay. Newton's wording of the third law is so crisp and beautiful that it has become a part of common language. For the same reason, perhaps misconceptions about the third law around. So let us note down some of the important points about this Newton's third law. So before that, let us consider a simple example. When you hit a ball on the wall from the wall, again, the ball comes, isn't it, in return. So, for every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction. That is one simple example for the Newton third law. So, now let us consider some of the important points in regard to the usage of the terms action and reaction. The first is the terms action and reaction in the third law mean nothing else but force. Using different terms for the same physical concept can sometimes be confusing. A simple and clear way of stating the third law is as with this statement. Like forces always occur in pairs and force on a body A by B is equal and opposite to the force on body B by A. Whatever the force is exerting on the A by B is equal and opposite to the force on the body B by A. Okay. And the second important point is the terms action and reaction in the third law may give a wrong impression that action comes before reaction. But that is not true. Action is the cause and reaction is the effect. There is no cause-effect relation implied in the third law. The force on A by B and the force on B by A act at the same instant. Okay, there is nothing that action comes first and then the reaction. So in that case, the force on A by B and the force on B by A, both they occur at the same instant. So by this, we can call any of the terms as action. The force which is exerted by B on B by A, we can call this as action. And the force which is on A by B, we can call this as reaction. And even we can call another way. Okay. So, and the third important point is action and reaction forces act on different bodies, not on the same body. Consider a pair of bodies A and B. According to the third law, FAB is equal to, it is minus of FBA because it is equal but opposite in direction. Thus, we are considering the motion of any one body, only one of the two forces is relevant. It is an error to add up the two forces and claim that the net force is zero. We can't do that. FAB plus FBA is equal to zero. That's a wrong idea because here the force action and reaction, they act on two different bodies. They are not acting on the same body. Here FAB is force on A by B, whereas FBA is force on B by A. So they are on two different bodies. So however, if you are considering the system of two bodies as a whole, then FAB and FBA are internal forces of the system. Then we can add those forces to get a null force. Internal forces in a body or a system of particles thus cancel away in pairs. So these are the some of the important points that we should consider while dealing with the third law of motion. Okay. So now let us study about the scientist Isaac Newton. Who is the main reason for all this? Who developed the laws of motion? Isaac Newton was born in Ulsthorpe, England in 1642, the year Galileo died. His extraordinary mathematical ability and mechanical aptitude remained hidden from others in his school life. In 1662, he went to Cambridge for undergraduate studies. A plague epidemic in 1665 forced the university town to close and Newton had to return to his mother's farm. There, in 2 years of solitude, his dormant creativity blossomed in a deluge of fundamental discoveries in mathematics and physics. Binomial theorem for negative and fractional exponents, the beginning of calculus, the inverse square law of gravitation, the spectrum of white light, and so on. Returning to Cambridge, he pursued his investigations in optics and devised a reflecting telescope also. So all these are the discoveries made by Sir Isaac Newton. Again in 1684, he, encouraged by his friend Edmund Halley, Newton embarked on writing what was to be one of the greatest scientific works ever published, the Principia Mathematica. In that he added the three laws of motion and the universal law of gravitation, which explained all the three Kepler laws of planetary motion. And the book was packed with a host of path-breaking achievements basic principles of fluid mechanics, mathematics of wave motion, calculation of masses on the Earth and the Sun and other planets, explanation of precession of equinoxes, theory of tides, etc. Newton brought out another masterpiece, Optics, that summarized his work on light and color. So the scientific revolution triggered by Copernicus and steered vigorously ahead by Kepler and Galileo was brought to a grand completion by Newton. Okay, Newton mechanics unified terrestrial as well as celestial phenomena. The same mathematical equation governed the fall of an apple to the ground and the motion of the moon around the earth. The age of reason had dawned. So these are all the achievements of Sir Isaac Newton. So now let us consider one more simple problem. Two identical billiard balls strike a rigid wall with the same speed but at different angles and get reflected without any change in speed, as shown in the figure. The first question is the direction of the force on the wall due to each ball, and the second question is the ratio of the magnitudes of impulses imparted to the balls by the wall. So here we can see the two balls, right? The two identical billiard balls strike a rigid wall with the same speed but at different angles. So here you can see the two balls. And get reflected without any change in speed. Okay, they get reflected without any change in speed. So we need to find the direction of the force on the wall due to each ball, in which direction the ball is moving towards the wall, and the ratio of the magnitudes of impulses which is imparted to the balls by the wall. So these two things we should find. So let us find the solution for this. So how to find the force on the wall? So that is the question, isn't it? So the trick is to find, to consider the force on the ball due to the wall using the second law. The trick is to consider the force on the ball due to the wall using the second law, then use the third law to answer. So first find the force, then use the third law to answer that. So let u be the speed of each ball before and after collision with the wall, and m is the mass of each ball. Okay, u is the speed of each ball before and after collision, and m is the, yes, m is the mass of each ball. So choose x and y axis as shown in this figure. This is the x axis and this is the y axis, and consider the change in momentum of the ball in each case. So the first case, so px, the change, the initial momentum in the x direction, we can call it as px initial, that is given by what? Mass into initial velocity. Okay, and we know that the initial velocity is zero, so therefore it becomes zero. And even if you consider if px final, the initial velocity is zero. The final velocity, that is minus m mu, in the opposite direction, isn't it? So similarly, in the y direction, if you consider py initial, that is also Since velocity is zero in the initially, it is also zero. And py final, if you consider in the opposite direction, this is minus m. No, py final is again zero. Okay, impulse is the change in momentum vector, therefore x component impulse will become minus 2mu and the y component impulse will become zero. So if you change in momentum is impulse, if you consider in x component it is minus 2mu, whereas in y component it is zero. Okay, impulse and force are in the same direction. Clearly from above, the force on the ball due to the wall is normal to the wall. The force on the ball due to the wall is normal to the wall along the negative x direction. So using third law of motion, the force on the wall due to the ball is normal to the wall along the positive x direction. So we can say the magnitude of the force cannot be ascertained since the small time taken for the collision has not been specified in the problem. Okay. Now they have asked one more question. The ratio of the magnitudes of impulses imparted to the balls by the walls. So now let us consider that. In that case, if you consider Px initial, that is mu cos 30. And py initial, if you consider in the y direction, that is given by mu sine 30. Here you can see it is making an angle of 30 degrees, isn't it? And similarly, Px final, we can consider it as mu cos 30 and Py final is given by mu sine 30. So note, while Px changes sign after collision and Py does not, so the x component of impulse is minus 2mu cos 30, whereas y component impulse is 0. So the direction of impulse is the same as in case A and it is normal to the wall along the negative x direction as we have discussed previously. And using the Newton's third law, the force on the wall due to the ball is normal to the wall along the positive x direction. So we can say the ratio of magnitudes of the impulses imparted to the balls in A and B is given by 2mu divided by 2mu cos 30. So, we can get the ratio as 2 by root 3, that is given by 1.2. Okay.